Well, we had the transmission out, and since we had to take most of the things apart, we decided to upgrade to a pair of Stainless Works headers. They're really nice, they fit well, and they went in pretty easily. We got lucky, none of the studs broke off in the heads, thankfully. It's a Southern car, so there's no rust on the studs to speak of, so we were very lucky there. And we had to take the right-hand motor mount out for the headers, which we had to take out to remove the old cooler lines, because they're 3/8 and we need half-inch for the 10R80, or a 6R80 would also. So we had to take that side apart anyway, so that worked out pretty well. A few minor things, we had to cut this motor mount, the ear off it slightly to clear the header, no damage to the motor mount, doesn't hurt it structurally. Well, now I've got good clearance there. And we slightly clearanced the right-hand header to give a little more room for the AC pressure relief valve in the back of the compressor. But all in all, it went pretty well. We did have to shorten the dipstick tube, has a little pilot on the end of it, and we had to cut about 3/8 of an inch off of that to get the dipstick tube to go back in. And when we did, it went right back in with no problem. So the headers hopefully will be a good upgrade, and we're looking forward to that. We bought them from Chris at ADTR. So thank you, Chris, for everything. And so with the wiring, we took the original transmission harness out, which is hanging here, held out of the way by the header for now. We tore out all of the transmission wiring from the 4R70W that was in it and left just the oxygen sensor wiring. And we took the transmission signals that we needed, like power, ground, and neutral safety, backup light, and took those over, and we're running them inside the vehicle for the controller. That won't be bare when we're done. We're just temporarily shoving it out of the way. We've got a grommet with some vacuum lines. We ran that through, which was very convenient. We didn't even have to cut a hole. So we'll dress all those wires when we're done. And then this is a 10R80 transmission harness. We don't have any of the stuff to make the connectors yet, although we're working on that. So we bought an F-150 harness and just modified it. Took all the oxygen sensors out of that one and stripped it down. That will go right to the controller as well. And with 6R80, it'd be very similar, except it'd be a different connector. We had to change the flex plate when we went to the 10R80 for actually two different reasons. One is the original flex plate, the 4R70W had the small 11-inch converter, which was used originally on the 4-valve engines and then later on some of the 2-valve engines like this one. It gives the car a little better launch and takes a little bit higher RPM than the full-size converter did. So it had an unusual 10.5-inch bolt pattern, whereas most Fords are like 11 3/8 or 11.5 inches between the studs and the converter. But that wasn't the only reason we had to change the flex plate. This is the 5-liter truck flex plate from a 2018 F-150. It's actually the same as the EcoBoost 3.5-liter as well. And there are several things different about this flex plate. It has the old bolt pattern with the 11 3/8, as would an earlier one of these. But the other problem was the backspacing on the converter. Picture the table being the crankshaft of the engine, and this is the crankshaft flange. On this one, the converter is about 0.01 of an inch closer to the engine, or not pushed back as far. This one, the converter is pushed back about 0.01 of an inch more. So this pushes the converter too far back into the transmission, so that's not good. We could mitigate that with a spacer between the bell housing and the transmission, but then we have other problems too. So we fixed this problem, and we have the converter further forward like it should be. But the ring gear is also different. The actual overall diameter is the same. This is the traditional 164-tooth Ford that's on most small blocks. There are a few exceptions, but that was or Windsors or, I mean, modular engines. And the Coyote until now. The 2018 Coyote and the 3.5-liter EcoBoost with the 10R80
have a 141 tooth ring gear. Same overall diameter, but the teeth are actually larger. They're more coarsely pitched. And the ring gear sits about 0.12 inches or roughly 3 millimeters further back from the crankshaft than it does in the traditional Coyote and modular flex plates. That definitely creates a starter compatibility problem. And since the 10R80 starter for the V8s is unique because it has the two-bolt pattern that's unique, we pretty much have to use that starter or adapt a different starter to it. So it's easier to use this flex plate if at all possible. And if you have an 8-bolt crankshaft, this flex plate is a bolt-on. So basically a Coyote engine, a later Windsor modular, or any modular with a forged crankshaft would have an 8-bolt flex plate. Unfortunately, this is a Romeo engine with 6 bolts, so we had to do a little bit of adapting here. It's not really ideal. It should hold the stock power level of the engine, but we used a reinforcement plate and did a little tack welding. Kept it true and flat and didn't overheat it when we tack welded it. I don't really recommend this for other people. This is more of a development thing, and later on we're either going to swap out the short block for one that has an 8-bolt crank or do something better. But to get this project going, this is how we approached it. We have the correct 6-bolt pattern now, and it should work fine with the power level this engine's at. Yeah, so as you can see, there's many reasons why we had to change the flex plate.